At one point during the advanced screening of Beetlejuice Beetlejuice that I got invited to, my contact lens started acting up, fell out of my eye and directly into my lap, and I can only assume that it was doing that so I wouldn't have to sit there and suffer through watching and seeing the rest of Beetlejuice Beetlejuice. Hi y'all, SnarkyJay Cosplay here. As of the time of this video's recording, the review embargo for Beetlejuice Beetlejuice has officially lifted. Now, I had the pleasure of watching this at an advanced screening last Wednesday, but you guys all know that, probably much to the chagrin of the people that make these things, even if you invite me to an early screening and give me a goodie bag, which I'm always grateful for, that's not going to impact the way that I review a movie. Now, before we get started, there will be a non-spoiler section that we're gonna get into right now, and a spoiler section near the end of the video. So if you're watching right now, feel free, I won't spoil a single thing. I can only give Beetlejuice Beetlejuice a 3.5 out of 10. Honestly, I don't have a huge attachment to the original, but I am a really big Tim Burton fan. Now, the first time I watched the first Beetlejuice, it felt a little out of left field for me, but I could definitely feel all those Tim Burton influences, and I genuinely did come to enjoy it, especially for the performances. You have to raise a glass to Michael Keaton every time. The guy's a master at his craft. So when I went in to watch Beetlejuice Beetlejuice, that's kind of what I wanted. I wanted a little more of that Tim Burton weirdness, the grittiness that's included in the original Beetlejuice, and I wanted more of Michael Keaton going off the fucking rails like he's so good at doing. And unfortunately, that's not what Beetlejuice Beetlejuice is really about. Unfortunately, the sequel to Beetlejuice is basically plagued by that 2024 modern day remake reimagining syndrome. What do I mean by that? The original film has its cartoony moments of campiness that are fun, a little offbeat, they're weird, but they're honestly enjoyable. And Beetlejuice Beetlejuice tries to bank on that same campiness and tries to bring it in, but it just does it in a way that's not quite as gritty or entertaining. It's sort of sanitized in a weird way. So all the offbeat cartoonishness from the first one just feels corny and kind of out of place in the second. I'll also say that the pacing is absolutely atrocious. There are moments that should be a lot faster than they are, and yet they last forever. And there's also like two different subplots in this movie that kind of make it impossible to want to follow just one, because none of the plots are really all that entertaining, so it's kind of hard to decide what you want to zone out of. And none of it is particularly enticing where you feel 100% you're buying into this movie. I'll also say that there is not nearly enough Beetlejuice in this film. I recently watched the original before watching this one, and I realized that Beetlejuice doesn't become a big part of the movie until about 45 minutes in. That's about the halfway mark. In this one, it feels like every time you get him, it's almost just a cameo. I never feel like Michael Keaton goes off the way he gets to in the original. I don't know if they were trying to sanitize him because he is kind of gross in a cancelable in 2024 way, and so I didn't feel like we were watching the same Beetlejuice we knew and loved. I kind of felt like we were watching a watered down, more tired version of him, and I don't think that that's chalked up to Michael Keaton's age. I feel like he could genuinely still do Beetlejuice just as well if they'd given him a script that really let him strut. Honestly, I can't say that this movie tries to nostalgia bait you too hard in regards to the original, but I can say that it feels like a sequel that maybe should have happened a million years ago and then got its wings clipped by 2024. Honestly, as somebody who likes offbeat, quirky movies, especially stuff by Tim Burton, I really expected to like Beetlejuice, and I did a whole Beetlejuice look for the premiere of this. I went in my giant boots, I did my makeup, I honestly was all in on this, and I sat down and found myself sighing and yawning and wishing it was over basically the entire time. I give it a 3.5 out of 10 purely because I feel like Michael Keaton did a really good job, and some of the shots stylistically do look really cool. We get a lot of different set pieces within this movie that I really appreciated, and Willem Dafoe actually plays a really fun and interesting character, so he's part of the reason for the rating. But honestly, a lot of the other performances kind of felt phoned in. I feel like they didn't let Michael Keaton do enough. I didn't feel that Winona Ryder and Jenna Ortega really had familial chemistry. Justin Theroux does the best he can with the job he's given, but I also feel like a 13-year-old wrote the script for him. The main storyline between Jenna Ortega's character Astrid and Winona Ryder's character Lydia Dietz adds this emotional kick that the original never had or needed, and honestly, it all just starts to feel out of place, and the movie fell apart for me very quickly. Honestly, this movie lacks in so many ways. 3.5 is the best I could give it, and even that is being kind of generous. Again, purely just because I think the source material is fun. Now, I've given you my rating of 3.5 out of 10. Now I want to talk some spoilers. So if you haven't seen the film or you're really worried about spoilers, this is the part where you click out and you come back after you've seen it. The main plot of Beetlejuice Beetlejuice essentially follows Lydia Dietz contending with her father's death as she also tries to reconcile her challenging relationship with her daughter Astrid. Lydia, after all this time, has basically sold out and is a TV medium psychic type. She talks to ghosts for money. Her manager, Justin Theroux, is also her boyfriend, who later becomes her fiance. And her daughter, Astrid, is still bitter over the death of her father, who apparently was eaten by piranhas. This is a real plot line. And she's very quirky and smart and dedicated to activism for climate change. And she's so quirky and smart that her Halloween costume is literally Marie Curie. Yeah, that's where we're at. Now there's a few things going on in this movie. After Lydia Dietz's father dies, it's her job with Delia to essentially clean up that old house they used to live in and get rid of everything. We're not gonna see any cameos from the Maitlands who were in the original, probably because Tim Burton just didn't want to have to pay Gina Davis and Alec Baldwin. Of course, in the cleaning process is when everything starts to go awry and Beetlejuice is back for more, because he still really wants to be with Lydia. While they're in town for Papa Dietz's funeral, a few different things happen. Lydia gets engaged to her manager and longtime scumbag boyfriend Rory at her dad's funeral. Jenna Ortega's character Astrid meets a boy and basically falls in love with him in 2 days, and this boy turns out to be a ghost who was once a murderer who killed his parents and then broke his neck while hiding from the police, and now he wants to steal her soul so he can live her life, and he drags her into the afterlife to do so. This sounds interesting. It's not. It's poorly played out. It's the part where my contact fell out. It really was trying to save me from something, and it all gets resolved entirely too quickly. Now, we also have the storyline where Beetlejuice is trying to get back to Lydia because he's never gotten over her, and in the midst of that, he's also being chased by Monica Bellucci, who I think her character's name was Dolores. I don't even remember at this point. And she's an Italian soul-sucking cult lady, and so they were once married, and now she's bitter that he left her and killed her or something. Again, none of these plot lines are particularly interesting. None of them have the same weird offbeat charm from the first one. And while we're focusing so long on the relationship between Lydia and Astrid, a lot of these other things go by the wayside. And so basically all we ever see of Beetlejuice's ex-lover Dolores is Monica Bellucci looking absolutely beautiful as she just traipses through different sets. That's basically the whole extent of it. And I feel like some of the issues with these plot lines are just the fact that they were trying to keep a PG-13 rating, and I can understand that that's important, but all of this just feels overly sanitized. And then the parts where they do go off the rails are just kind of weird and take too long. Like when Monica Bellucci's character Dolores is resurrected, she has to put herself back together with staples, and she does this to the tune of Tragedy by the Bee Gees, but she looks so incredibly bored the entire time she does it, and the music doesn't quite match, and it feels like that goes on for about 5 minutes. I wouldn't be surprised if that's how long it actually took. And so it's these things that feel like they should be like, oh, that's disturbing, good on you, Tim, you got me. And yet they just take so long to resolve themselves that you're kind of like, okay, I get it. Can we just move on? I mean, look, is Beetlejuice Beetlejuice a movie that real fans of the original might like? Yeah, I can acknowledge that I'm often the problem when it comes to these things. My dad also was not a fan of the movie for the same reasons. I think This movie just suffers from that 2024 syndrome, exactly what I said earlier. It feels like it wants to harken back to the original, but they just don't have the balls to do it anymore. So the parts that are weird, they take too long and they're just oddly paced out. And then the parts that maybe should be a little bit more exciting, they can't because they have to keep that rating, they have to keep it politically correct. It just feels sanitized in an odd way. It's not fun campy, it's corny campy, and you don't get enough of the characters you'd really want to see more of. Michael Keaton's Beetlejuice doesn't feel like he gets to do nearly enough in this movie because he's too busy trying to solve everybody else's problems and almost playing a side character to this family plot issue between Astrid and Lydia. I feel like this movie has good bones and could have been way better than it was, but unfortunately I was not particularly impressed with Beetlejuice Beetlejuice at all, and that's why my rating of 3.5 out of 10 stands. Don't let me stop you from watching or renting it. You might enjoy it a lot more than I did. I don't have a particularly strong connection to the original, so maybe if I'd been a bigger fan of it, I would have bought into this one a little bit more, but honestly, even after goodie bags and photo ops, I can't say I was particularly enthused with Beetlejuice Beetlejuice. And that's all from me. I've been Snarky Jay. Thank you so much for watching. Please don't forget to like and subscribe. For more Snarky Jay, be sure to check me out on Instagram. And if you'd like to support me, this channel, and my content creation, do check out and consider subscribing to my Patreon for exclusive photo shoot sets and cosplay content. I will add links to all of those in the description below. And let me know your thoughts on Beetlejuice Beetlejuice in the comments below.